Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And hello guys, come back to Suara Kitani Studio. My name is Hazman Haji Hassan, and now we are at the Legislative Council in Bandar Seberkawan, where we are actually going to be attending a youth forum co-organized by YPN, which is Young Professional Network, and KKBS, Kementerian Kebudayaan Bilia dan Sukan, where they will be holding a youth forum theme of resilient youth and resilient nation. So as for today, we're gonna ask some questions with the youth and the speakers of this forum, and asking them how the Bruneians youth or people of Brunei react to this topic. And let's directly ask the attendees to find out.
Nama saya Muhammad Syukri bin Zulkifli. Saya seorang pelajar di Talias University Malaysia.
My name is Awangku Iskandar Fayyadh bin Pengiran Haji Mohd Hasreen.
Saya Fariszal Ali, penolong kaunselor penjara di Jabatan Penjara Negara Brunei Salam.
My name is Hajah Nora. I'm a counselor, mental health and addiction coach in Clarity, and I'm also the founder of Cure Heart.
Hi, my name is Pengiran Salimatul Saada binti Penumat Saleh, or also known as Ninja Tutul on social media. But I'm also working full-time as an educational psychologist at Jabatan Pendidikan Khas MOE.
I'm 643, Colonel Norsuriati binti Haji Sharbini. I'm a military officer. I've been recently promoted to be a full colonel in the Royal Brunei Armed Forces.
My name is Dr. Iskandar Hasnan. I'm the Assistant Chief Youth Officer at the Ministry of Culture and Sport.
My name is Fatin, as the co-founder of the Young Professionals Network.
I am Lieutenant Qurratu'aini Qayyimah, Dr. Al-Haj Zelzy. I'm a naval officer working in the Royal Brunei Navy, and I've been in service for almost 7 years now.
Right, so with the COVID happening, then Malaysia is currently under lockdown. How do you feel like doing your classes online? And since the final year, I believe some of the students final year usually they have big projects. So how do you cope with that?
Well, to be honest, ideally I would say it's being in campus physically is way more, more comforting, to be around people and friends. It's kind of depressing to do it online, but yeah, it is what it is lah. So I keep myself busy with volunteering. I'm also doing my internship at Recap in Berhad, which is a consulting firm on tech. So yeah, I just keep being myself busy while studying as well.
All right, so means that you are actually looking forward to learn about what law do we have regarding mental illness in here. So what's your perspective regarding the law in Brunei regarding this? Are we handling it right, or are we lacking us every single thing to protect these people and stuff like that?
I mean, to be honest, I feel that I've not really fully looked into the laws of Brunei yet, but as a young nation, we don't really have the exact laws to actually provide the necessary guidelines. It's still open up for discussion, so I think that really provides an opportunity for us to kind of really discuss on do we actually as a young nation, do we still need to have these laws to actually build ourselves and make our country more resilient, or do you think our existing laws could already accommodate these issues? I think personally, as a law student, I think that maybe we could improve, and maybe we could actually add some more, have different statutes to provide such guidelines, so that again, those who have such mental disorders could have the necessary support.
So usually, what kind of common illness yang mental illness yang happening dalam penjara tu?
Okay, yang biasanya masa mula-mula masuk penjara tu lah. Masa mula-mula masuk penjara tu, di sanalah masalah tekanan itu berlaku. Diorang akan mula risau akan anak bini bis diorang, macam contoh keluarga diorang di luar lah, kebanyakan macam itu, dan macam mana untuk menghadapi hukuman yang bis diorang hadapi itu. Contohnya ada yang kena penjara 10 tahun contohnya. Jadi diorang masa mula-mula masuk tu, diorang akan rasa macam tekanan itu, macam mana untuk menghadapi hukuman selama 10 tahun itu. Jadi inilah yang dibantu ni untuk membuka minda bis diorang, diberikan sesi counseling dan sebagainya, supaya diorang dapat menerima akan keadaan baru itu, macam mana untuk menjalani kehidupan norma barunya kata ni, tapi dalam penjara, bukannya COVID macam mana diorang akan melaluinya. Ini yang penting, sebab itu apabila kata ni bantu bis diorang untuk membuka minda, kemudian mengajak bis diorang untuk bergaul dengan penduduk-penduduk lain, contohnya berkumpulkan dalam counseling kelompok dan sebagainya. Jadi diorang mula-mula ada memahami macam mana keadaan dalam penjara tu, dan alhamdulillah sudah beberapa minggu melalui baru dia dapat menurunkan sedikit tekanan itu. Cuma yang satu lagi tekanan itu apabila habis dia orang akan bebas. Ini selalu. Selalunya tekanan yang diorang hadapi ini, pertama macam mana tangkapan dewis diorang, macam mana akan berhadapan dengan masyarakat. Yang kedua macam mana untuk balik semula dengan keluarga yang selalu berpandangan negatif sama dewis diorang. Dan banyak lagi lah, cuma termasuk pekerjaan dan sebagainya. Alhamdulillah kata saya tadi, ada proses-prosesnya lah yang dibuat untuk membantu dewis diorang ini supaya menambahkan keyakinan dewis diorang selain mengikuti program-program yang telah disediakan oleh Jabatan Penjara itu sendiri.
I'm quite surprised when you mention those like 5 years old apa tu. How do they can become like your patient? I mean, what happens? Macam, why?
So, kalau usually for my patient yang my client yang damit-damit itu, usually because of their parents, you know, parents who are divorced, processing divorce, or someone who have issues at school, skapa. So that's why. So when they come to me, I have our techniques lah. We have our techniques. So macam, okay, example, I said. Like I said, can you draw something? What is your issues with your parents? So dorang buat tu macam like a broken heart, like oh satu macam like I said, what is the broken heart is yeah, because my mom and my dad is not together anymore. So that is another therapy that how I tackle lah for kanak-kanak. So because kanak-kanak it's not easy for them to how to say to luahkan, okay? So I do from art therapy and writing as well, yeah.
So as a teacher before, how do you handle students who have having mental illness?
So when it comes to children, just to put context sikit lah, I was formerly a pra and lower primary school teacher. So I teach pra year 1-3 lah, mostly. So when it comes to children, memang kanak-kanak bukannya ya faham ya ada mental illness kan macam, but you can see kanak-kanak tu datang sekolah mukanya sedih, and then dia banyak engage sama kawannya ataupun indah mendengar masa tani mengajar. Of course macam ketani pun indah juga kan bercakap sama dorong, are you stressed? Mas kanak-kanak bukannya faham apa stresnya ni kan. But we know that there is a problem lah from home. Pasal kanak-kanak ni, they are naturally happy, ceria, suka bermain. Kalau nampak kanak-kanak yang diam-diam tu, then there must be something wrong. So what I usually do is, I always make sure that they are included in all of the activities. Kadang-kadang ada masanya macam, kalau murid tu ramai tak lagi ya, you have to mesti peka lah of all your students still, regardless of sibuk ke apa. Make sure dorang involved, and then make sure they have buddies. So walaupun sekiranya dorang ni dah pandai berkawan, so make sure seorang itu yang friendly jenisnya, jadi buddy-nya lah. So untuk macam membawa ia ke kantin, membawa ia ke jamban ke apa. So, I feel that school for some children, especially those yang don't have the privilege of having a safe environment di rumah, you know lah. School is actually a safe place for them lah. So that's why sekolah dan guru-guru memainkan peranan yang sangat penting untuk kanak-kanak cuman ni, because di rumah we don't know what happens at home, dorang nak kena peduli ke apa. I have some students yang dorang rather sekolah dan yang mau cuti sekolah tu, alah boring cuti sekolah, lagi syok sekolah macam tu, because di sekolah tah dorang happy. They're happier in school daripada di rumah.
What are the things that we should make changes, or what we should be more focused on to become a resilient youth in Brunei Darussalam?
I think first and foremost, resilience is something that everyone must have in this current unpredictable world that we live in. It's just because that I think when you look at how we have evolved as a nation, where we were, I like to say a decade ago, where we were before and where we are now, we have youths that are intelligent, that have progressed a lot, that are more astute when it comes to world economics and politics, do know what they want to strive in life, do want to make that positive impact and whatnot. With that comes the challenges of being disappointed so often, okay? So you want something so badly, and then you're disappointed because you feel that you've done all these things. Your expectation increases with knowledge, with all those stuff. So what is required, I think, for the youth nowadays is to look at a very holistic picture, right? To go beyond what they think they know, to challenge themselves, go beyond the borders of saying that this is what I think, but to start questioning, hang on, is there any other things that I should think about, should do about?
As I said in the forum, don't compare yourself with others. I've been receiving all this advice from a friend. And then the person said, you know, don't compare yourself with others anymore. This is the things that gives you anxiety, and gives you much motivation. Because the point is, for us to be a youth resilient, you need to believe in yourself. But how do you believe in yourself? That you need to find your own confidence. To be as a resilient youth, you need to learn to face those challenges. Contoh, I didn't share it during the forum. I was actually a victim of being bullied in school. So for me, if I stayed at the particular, in that particular situation,
yes.
I will be stuck in that environment for a long time. So if I don't change, who's going to help me? Of course, my friend, I do acknowledge that they are the one you're helping me. But then again, I built myself, I stood up by myself, because for me, it is important for me to change my own, you know. Because the thing is, people always compare yourself and then they undermine their own capability, they undermine their own beliefs and dreams, and then they're always influenced by listening to people criticizing.
Patients that we've had with our youth, mental health topic has been one of the most popular ones lah. And what we realize is that I think that we have not mainstream the conversations just yet. So we felt it's about time then we start having a healthy conversation, healthy dialogue about mental health and how we as a nation can actually develop more resilient youth. Because I think that by having resilient youth is very, very important to the development of the country. Because, you know, we need young people who are energetic, young people who are healthy in their mental state, with strong capacity to contribute to national development.
There are a lot of skills that we can develop to be resilient, but the most important ones, I think, would be skills such as stress management, problem solving, critical thinking, and tenacity, basically to be strong, lah, because this will allow you to go about your day-to-day activities and also help you pursue your goals, your ambitions. Those are the skills that I feel are much relevant right now, especially in this COVID-19 times. And yeah,
I see. There you go, guys. That was the youth forum organized by YPN and also KKBS of Brunei Darussalam, where they talk about mental illness and becoming a resilient youth in Brunei Darussalam. So what do you think of these two topics, mental health and resilient youth? If you have any comments, do comment below. I hope you guys enjoy the forum. I will see you guys soon for our next project. Keep updated with our podcast, keep updated with our video and video channel on YouTube. Alright, see you guys. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, and signing out. Okay, I'm gonna go.